que esté acá con nosotros. Estuvo trabajando un tiempo también en la Universidad de Texas, con la Fundación Simon, con Gustavo de Veciana. Y allí fue la última vez que nos encontramos, porque fue una conferencia que me invitó. Y bueno, con él trabajamos en los modelos de geometría aleatoria, que todos ustedes han escuchado en las múltiples charlas del seminario. Así que nada, buenísimo que esté acá y escuchar estos modelos también, cómo se suman a tratar de entender esto de la pandemia. So, bueno, it's a great pleasure to have Franca with us today. Gogo?
Okay.
I would like to thank also Daniel Kaufman, who made the connection, because he was our Uruguayan ambassador in this situation. So, thank you.
Yes.
Okay, very good. I first would like to thank you for the invitation. It's a great pleasure. I visited Montevideo, I think, twice at least, perhaps three times, I believe. And I also visited, we organized things with Pablo also, who is attending. So I've had great interactions with several persons in Uruguay and Argentina. So it's really great to have this opportunity to talk to you about, ongoing work. So let me share my screen. Let's see, I succeeded. Let's see whether I can succeed twice. Start broadcast. Okay. Fair enough. Okay, now good notes and the slides. Can you see my slides? Paola, yes. Do you see my slide?
Yes, yes.
Okay, very good. Okay, the title is Contact Processes on Point Processes, and I would like to start with a sort of a disclaimer. It is ongoing work. It's partly linked to a personal wish to try to understand what is going on with this effect of lockdown on the propagation of epidemics. And I was explaining just a few minutes ago to Paola how this thing started. So I will say a few words on that. Right? Okay. So this is joint work with a PhD student at UT Austin, Nitin. And we have a sort of preliminary preprint posted on archive. Okay. And so the general idea is the following. So, and I have to explain how it started. I mean, I've been working with on stochastic geometry for a while, and I started getting into dynamics of point processes and dynamics of stochastic geometry objects a few years ago with another PhD student with now in Berkeley, Abhishek Sankararaman and Sergei Foss. So we have started this way of thinking of looking at dynamics, birth and death processes, where the death is triggered by something which is a function of a shot noise process of the configuration. So, and with the motivation being in wireless communications. At the beginning of the pandemic, we had this lockdown in France, and I started thinking about trying to import some of the ideas that we had developed for this dynamics of point processes triggered by shot noise. Say something is triggered by shot noise. So in the initial thing that we did with Abhishek, it was you would complete the transfer of a file with a rate which was inversely proportional to some shot noise. Which is linked to Shannon's theory, to try to look at other dynamics where the shot noise triggers other things than death, but possibly a transition from a state, uninfected to infected. As we all know, since we wear masks, I mean, it's because of contact and close by contact within a certain ball that infection takes place, and so it looked natural to try and to use some of the things which are for part of them rigorous, for part of them heuristics, to try to understand how this epidemic propagate on when you take geometry into account, the geometry of infection. And also our aim or my aim initially was to try to understand the effect of reduction of mobility. So hence the sort of title of this preliminary work, which is on the evaluation of the role of mobility on the propagation of epidemics on point processes. Okay, so that's the setting. Fair enough. So I will first describe the SIS dynamics on point processes with motion, then a few structural results, then this moment measure equations, which we imported from the things that we do on in wireless, or in other things, we looked at peer-to-peer dynamics also, which are in a sense of similarities. And then we go to, in a sense, the more practical things. We want to predict things and to get a sort of handle on these questions on the role of mobility. And we'll deduce from some transformation of this moment measure equations, a certain number of functional equations and polynomial equations, which describe heuristically the steady state densities of these dynamics. This produces what we call a tentative phase diagram, which is, say, a sort of conjecture at this stage, which gives in function of the parameters the regions where there is survival and the regions where there is extinction. And I will show we developed a simulator to study to sort of validate. So validation is very difficult because, I mean, we look at translation invariant dynamics on the whole plane or the whole Euclidean space. I mean, it's about the same, but we looked at the plane so far. And so simulating that is basically impossible. And this, so we look at the big torus to simulate. It's very computationally intensive, and it's only a very partial validation that we have, right? So, okay. Fair enough. So first, do you have a question on the setting, or should I start? Is it clear? Okay, good. So let's go to SI dynamics on the Poisson point process with spatial migration. Okay, so think of individuals forming a spatial configuration psi of t at time t on RD. And each individual has a state which is either infected or susceptible. Okay, and think of the classical SIS evolution, which is the one that people look at in the simplest model in these dynamics, where an individual moves from S to I or I to S alternatively, and transition from susceptible to infected is a function of a local infection rate, which I will define in a second. And the transition from infected to susceptible is with a constant recovery rate, right? So this is, of course, one can complexify that at will. But I mean, as often in, say, mathematics or applied mathematics, we want to look at the simplest problem first and then try to enrich. Okay, and you combine this SIS evolution with a spatial evolution, which can be controlled in terms, as we shall see, which is a migration with, say, constant rate. So an individual at a rate which we'll define in a second, this will use sort of Markov model in an extended state space, will jump and make a big jump in the Euclidean plane, say, at a given constant rate, the rate of decide you stay fixed, put, and then suddenly you decide to migrate, you take a plane and you go to from Paris to Montevideo and you keep your SIS state as you move, right? And these displacements, so there will be a clock to decide of the decision to migrate, or to take this trip, and there will be independent displacement in R2. Okay, so this is the board setting. Okay, so let's call Xi zero the location at time zero. So, and we will take Poisson homogeneous assumption of intensity, say lambda on R2. Okay, this is the initial condition. And then to be a bit more specific now, we have a random way, what we call a random waypoint model. So it's a thing which people use in engineering to describe motion. So it could be called a lazy random walk if you want. So points, but of a certain type. So points jump according to a certain clock with rate gamma, which will be the things that you can control. I mean, you can forbid trips and gamma will be zero, or you can restrict trip and take very few trips with gamma being small, very rarely people move and so forth. When this clock ticks for a given individual, this individual has a random displacement, which says symmetric on R2, say a Gaussian displacement, okay? And very soon we'll go to the core of the thing. Currently we only study the case where this displacement is big. So it could be a centered displacement, I say Gaussian in R2, centered and with big variance, something of this type. Okay, but it's important, it's symmetric for parts of the theory. Okay, and so this leads, if you forget about the SI state, to a ground point process, Xi t, which at time t, which is the sort of lazy random walk or random waypoint displacement of these Poisson points independently. And it's very classical, it's so-called displacement theorem of point process theory, that at all times, Xi t is Poisson lambda, thanks to this classical displacement theorem. So if you displace independently Poisson points, you keep the Poisson property. Okay. And now comes the basic SI dynamics, which comes on top of that. So there is the interaction function F. And so you can go beyond, but I will restrict myself to present me the simplest meaningful model to this famous 2 meter or or more, but you could have something different. But so there is a this F of R, which is an infection rate alpha, provided the distance is less than A. So there are two constants, alpha and A, and it's isotropic. We will look at an isotropic infection rate, nothing directional, right? Okay, and so this will trigger the infection, total infection rate, later on through a shot noise, as we shall see. Okay, and so now the points of this Xi of t are in any of two states, infected or susceptible, say infected 1, susceptible 0, and this splits at any time the point process Xi as a sum in the same superposition of two point processes, the sum of two measures, if you want, counting measures, phi t like infected, and psi t like susceptible. And the key thing will be that, unfortunately, neither phi t nor psi t are Poisson. The sum is Poisson, but there are lots of intricate correlation structure between the two. And now comes the SIS dynamics, which is the one you already guess. So at time t, think of a point x that belongs to the support of the counting measure psi t of susceptible. So look at the susceptible point. You look at the shot noise created, namely the total infection rate, which is additive around this point, so you see the structure of the shot noise here. So you count all those which are within this disk around x and add alpha as many times as there are points there, and this will be the transition rate of x from phi t to Oh, sorry, this will be the transition rate to state one for this point of x that now will belong to the infected, right? This is the infection rate. And the other rate, which is easy, now is a constant. So a point which is infected recovers with a rate beta. So that's okay. And so you combine that with the migration dynamics, which is actually a far random waypoint model. Namely, there is this migration rate gamma. So there is this independent exponential clock for every point. Then you make these very large displacements in R2, say according to a Gaussian or something of this type. Okay, so that's the dynamics. So let me try to illustrate what this dynamics looks like. So I think, I hope you can see my screen. Let's look at this motion case. Okay, so this is the dynamic. So you see the red, which would be infected, the blue susceptible, and the points at the same time move and infect each other, and when infected recover and things like that, right? So at any time you get a sort of Boolean model on Poisson point process, but there is this state structure, SI state structure, which and as you see, I mean, you see that very well that blue points are so clustered and red points are clustered. If you are infected, you have more chance to have infected around you. And so the you, of course, I mean, cannot claim or expect that this point process be very simple Poisson or anything like that. It's much more complex. Okay. Is the picture and the dynamic clear, or would you like to discuss it before I go on? No question?
I have.
Yes.
The lines in your illustration are the points that are near that with distance less than alpha.
Yes, less than A. Alpha is the infection rate.
Alpha is infection rate. I mean, less than A.
Yes, A. Right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so this connected graphs are like the Boolean model superposition.
Indeed. Yeah. Yeah. If you forget about the state, I mean, you see that it's a dynamical Boolean model because points move, right? So, and the key thing is that, I mean, here I have a sequence of pictures, right? I did not describe because it's too slow. The continuous time dynamics. But if you take a point here, so if you take this picture, perhaps this point here, okay, we'll make a jump and we'll go somewhere here. Another point here will go here and so forth according to the displacement. And so then, but the point carries its type, infected or susceptible, and can bring the disease somewhere far, even in areas which are not infected, based on this migration, right? But indeed, at any point of time, you see a Boolean model, and this Boolean model is depicted by its Gilbert graph, where you see the edges of the Gilbert graph here. Does it answer your question?
Yeah.
And the time scale of the migration is different, is great, larger than the scale of contagions.
Well, so that's indeed a very good question. And the phase diagram will discuss all these type of things. Okay, so if you look at, so you have parameters here, okay. you have these parameters. There is the infection which carries the alpha here. So if you forget about geometry, just look at rate. There is the beta, which is recovery rate, and they play in the same league. And then there is the gamma, which is the, and so a priori you could let's take gamma very small compared to alpha and beta. It would be one regime, or very big, and it would be another regime. So, but we don't, at this stage, we don't, the phase diagram will try to sort out these things out later.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so questions now are, you have this alpha, beta, gamma, and mu, which is the average degree of a node in this Boolean model, lambda pi a square. And you ask, so first, I mean, is the dynamic well-defined on the whole of R2? Because we want to, use moment measure and stationarity. So to get an analytic handle, otherwise it's very difficult. And for this set of parameters, let's say you have four parameters, basic parameters, does the epidemic survive or not? Okay, so so it's a difficult question here. So on a compact, when the state where nobody is infected is absorbing, and then nothing happens in terms of the epidemic, and so you have to define these things in a reasonable way in infinite space setting, phase space, and so we'll try to do that in a second. And then you ask other questions while holding everything constant. How does varying gamma act on the epidemic survival? Gamma indeed is the sort of lockdown control parameters that you may play with, and you may reduce it to something very small or to zero. Does it? What is the effect on the survival? What does even survival mean? So I will try to come to that in a second. But so let's ask the questions in mundane terms first. And then when the epidemic does survive, what fraction of the population is infected in the steady state? Okay, so think of the dynamics we have seen, and we have seen something settling where you see red points on this big torus, and you ask about what is the fraction of node which is infected in steady state? Okay, so these are the questions. Okay, so steady state and compact phase spaces is degenerate, as I said. Extinction is almost surely certain because everybody understands it. It's an absorbing state in a Markov chain. A Markov chain is easy to devise in this case. So the focus of this study is on the dynamics on the whole of RD, which are space-time invariant. Okay, space-time, so indeed we have taken this Poisson at any time, displacement preserved Poisson, so space invariance is clear. And we look at steady state, so it will be invariant by translation. You are interested in dynamics which are invariant in time and space, namely RD plus one, if you want. Okay, and so we'll use two mathematical machineries, contact processes mathematics developed in particle systems, and this moment measure rate conservation methods, which are borrowed from the wireless and peer-to-peer. Okay, so the properties of the dynamics, I will try to first describe, I mean, the classical tools, say, of Liggett. The key thing is that the pair phi t psi t is Markov on the space of counting measures. So it's a complex and continuous state space. So it's not so easy to manipulate and if you take this migration being triggered by Poisson clock, this displacement being independent, and this infection rate to be this shot noise, it is clear that you have sufficient statistics knowing the configuration at time t to look at the transitions of every point from infected to susceptible or from susceptible to infected. So you have a nice Markov property. you can make a construction on compact of time for infinite state spaces. By looking at the graphical constructions, which are those of particle systems. I will try to explain that briefly or recall it in a second. You can extend the basic properties of the contact process on graphs, on deterministic graphs, by proving some sort of monotonicity property, additivity property, and the duality, self-duality property, which are similar to those of the SIS dynamics or contact process on deterministic graphs. Yes?
Il y a quelqu'un qui... Oh, there is a question.
Yes?
I don't know, MT. I don't know who is. Someone raised his hand.
Es Enrique.
Ah, Enrique. ¿Fue por error?
Perdonen, no estoy en mi casa y estoy con un aparato que no conozco muy bien.
Okay, okay. Sorry, Francois. Go ahead.
Okay, good.
It was a mistake.
And so the monotonicity property says that if you say on, let me phrase it for a deterministic graph, and then it, you could do it conditionally on the initial condition of the graph. So if you take initial conditions where there are more infected in phi zero than in phi zero tilde, then at all times for a proper coupling, you will have more infected at time t than in the evolution from the initial condition phi zero than with the phi zero tilde. The additivity that you can also prove by a graphical argument that if you look at the point process of in a proper coupling, the point process of infected node at time t for an initial condition, which is the union of A and B. So you take first set A of infected nodes, another set B of infected nodes, and you look at what happens at time t, then this will be the union of the point process or the superposition, if you want, if you don't count multiplicity, of those infected in the configuration I at A at time t and those infected in the configuration at time t with initial condition B. This holds for all A, B, and t. And the most important is a self-duality property, which is based on the time reversal argument, which is says that if you depart from a set A infected and ask whether there is somebody infected in set B at time t, it is equal to the probability starting from B as a set of infected node that there is at least one node in A which is infected at time t. Okay, so so this goes with based on graphical representation. So I mean, this is classical, and I don't want to describe it because I want to go to the core. But basically, you put you define a graphical model. So there is, for instance, you see, I mean, a node here. This node will jump and will have the rest of his life here. On each of those, you put recovery times, which are potential recovery times, right? And for every node, you send arrows to the neighboring nodes at distance less than r, provided these other nodes are distance less than r, right? So again, exponential clocks. And then you look at sort of feasible paths, namely paths of infection where you you see no recovery, and these paths indeed have a good a good description of the infection process, and you look at the union of this path, and this determines the state of any node at any time. Right? So, and you can do that in the infinite state space. On a Poisson point process with this motion, and so it allows you to define things on any compact of time. Okay, so it's not classical things in okay. Now come the notion of extinction, and which you can phrase this way: you say there is extinction is if the probability that phi t is different from the nth state at any time t, starting from one infected node. So you could say, look at the palm distribution, for instance, take a specific node, take call it zero, infect it, and look at the chance that the epidemic is different. I mean, the phi t is different from zero at any time. And if it is zero, if the chance of that is zero, then you say that there is extinction. say there is survival if there is not extinction. And you can say, let's say you define that under under the palm, for instance, and this thing doesn't depend on the identity of the infected node, initially infected node. Okay, and the key thing is that when you fix all parameters other than beta, there exists a beta critical, which may be degenerate, such that is beta less than beta critical, there is survival. And if beta is more than beta critical, there is extinction. Okay, so that's the definition, formal definition of extinction. Now comes a very important object, which also was discussed by Liget, and that we can extend to this case. There exists a maximal stationary probability measure. Namely, you depart from all nodes infected. Phi zero is the whole Xi. You can prove that then phi t is stochastically decreasing. Okay, so this is like in Loyn's theory. I mean, use this monotonicity, and out of that, everything decreasing converges, and this will be the maximal stationary solution. So it's quite a very classical argument. And when you use self-duality, you can prove this very beautiful result. Which is in Liget's book already, but just adapted here, that there is a direct relation between survival probability and maximum invariant measure, in the sense that if you call P the probability that the typical node is infected in the maximal invariant measure, this P is also equal to the probability that the starting from a single initial node infected, there is no extinction, there is survival, right? The probability that phi t is different from the empty set for all t. Okay, but that's what we called probability of survival. Okay, it's okay, good. Okay, so this is the sort of setting. Now I can move to the setting, which is the computational setting, which are moment measure equations. So in the rate conservation principle, these are tools of palm calculus. Assume there is a stationary time-space stationary regime, and in a sense, we already answered this question using this maximal solution. There may be others than the maximal one. Let's call P the spatial intensity of the stationary phi, state of infected nodes. Psi, P will be the probability that infected. So this point process will have intensity lambda P. The other one, the susceptible lambda 1 minus P. Let's look at the infection rate, I phi, at any locus x of R2, okay? And because we are in this in a space stationary regime, we can use Campbell's formula and get the value of the infection rate at a typical locus, say zero, it's translation invariant, which would be lambda p alpha pi a square, right? So just by Campbell's formula. Good. Now, the interesting thing is the spatial infection rate. Let's call I the you pick say a domain D of volume one, any measurable set of volume one. You look at all points which are susceptible in this region, and you look at how much infection rate they suffer, right? And so again, by the definition of palm, this is lambda one minus p palm expectation with respect to the psi point process, which is stationary, of the infection rate at the origin, right? So what is the palm expectation? The palm expectation of the typical the infection rate seen by the typical susceptible. Okay, so these are just definitions, and so. So now you can also devise, it's much more easy, the spatial recovery rate, again, lambda p beta, so just first principles. And the rate conservation principle of palm calculus says that I should be equal to R. namely, P beta is equal to 1 minus P, palm expectation under the susceptible of the infection rate seen by the typical susceptible, right? Okay, very good. And so this will be over and over. We'll use a rate conservation principle by equating quantities which should increase in a domain as much as they decrease, right? The number of infected rate, if it's a steady state, this is palm calculus, which well, first principles which allow to state it, and palm calculus which allow to make it formal. You get equations relating certain quantities by looking at the equilibrium dynamics. In saying that this dynamics is at equilibrium. Okay, what are implications of this right conservation principle of order one? A natural conjecture, it's already visible in the videos that I've shown, is that there is repulsion between phi and psi, namely that the which you can translate into this inequality, is that the palm expectation, namely the infection rate, which is good in fact, seen by a typical susceptible, is actually less than the space stationary value of the infection rate. Okay, so we have not proved this conjecture, but so there is evidence that it holds. And we will leverage that later, but it's not, there are lots of conjectures. I said it's very wet, so lots of work to be done. Okay, but under the this repulsion conjecture, you can deduce that if you call mu the mean degree, mu is lambda pi a square, if alpha mu is less than beta, then there is extinction, and if alpha mu more than beta, then one may have a non-degenerate stationary regime. So, okay. And so in the last case, the fraction of infected node satisfies the bound that P is less than 1 minus beta over alpha mu and is positive, right? And another conjecture is that the second bound is tight in the high motion mean field regime. So, and again, there is simulation and discrete time evidence. We have a proof in discrete time that if gamma is very high, P, it's very easy to understand, will be this 1 minus beta of alpha mu. Okay, so these are first things. You can rephrase actually this rate conservation principle for first one measure in terms of properties of the pair correlation function of these point processes. Okay, so it goes like this. So let's call xi of infected susceptible of x, the pair correlation function at x, x is in a point in R2, of the pair of point processes phi and psi. So another way of stating it is that this is, in a sense, assuming that you have a point at zero, which is susceptible, okay? This gives the density or the chance in a small volume around x to find a point of type phi. And you can rewrite in terms of, this is called the pair correlation function, and you can rewrite this palm expectation in terms of an integral of the f function. If there would be no correlation between the two point processes, this thing would be one. It would just be the classical Campbell formula. But there is a bias, or there is a correction term, multiplicative correction term, which is to the classical Campbell formula, which is this pair correlation function. Okay. And you can rewrite, therefore, RCP1, the percolation, the reconstruction principle in integral form. So you remember what it was. So it was given here. Okay. So P beta is 1 minus P, this Palm expectation. So you will rewrite the Palm expectation in terms of this integral representation. The P's, if P is different from zero, can be simplified, and you get an integral equation, which says that actually the F function is known, right? It's but it gives a constraint on this unknown pair correlation function between the susceptible and the infected, in which known parameters show up, lambda, beta, and here is hidden in F, A, and alpha, but also in terms of the P, which is unknown. So you establish a connection, a functional connection between the first moment measure, P, and the second moment measure, Xi. And this will be systematic. That's what we understood with Ilkka Noros and Fabien Mathieu years ago. For this type of dynamics triggered by shot noise, what you get are functional relations, sort linking here for RCP1, first moment measure and second moment measure. And later on, we'll relate second moment measure and third moment measure. Okay, so in a sense, it makes sense because, when transition rate is triggered by shot noise are additive, so therefore, linear functional on the point process. And in a sense, when you have a transition rate leads to sort of burst and death equations on moment measure. So you relate the k's moment measure to the k minus first and the k plus first. This is the sort of typical situation that you get in these dynamics. And indeed, what you can do is extend this approach to second moment measure. So you can introduce pair correlation function between susceptible, infected and infected, susceptible and susceptible. We already defined this one. They are related by a conservation equation, which comes from the fact that their sum is Poisson. Therefore, the pair correlation function of the sum is 1. So you have a conservation rule. And what you can do in the same principle, and I don't want to spend too much time on that, you write conservation relations on each of these pair correlation function. And it goes like that. So we explained the principle briefly. You introduce this type of object. Okay. So let me spell it out. So mu phi 0 r of psi phi of x. So it's a conditional density of phi at x. Okay. So phi is a point process. Mu is with conditional density, the conditional chance to find a point at x of phi, given that psi has a point at 0, 0, and phi has a point at r0. Okay, so there is a symmetry of rotation, so you can simplify things like that. It's enough to, okay. And same thing, you introduce another object of the same nature. So this mu phi of 0 r of now psi psi x, the conditional density of phi at x, given that there is a susceptible at 0, 0 and a susceptible at 0 r. You need 3-point things in order to write now the RCP2, namely how you get a conservation law, a conservation function equation between second moment measure or pair correlation function and third. Okay, so as you see, these are a surrogate of third moment measure. You look at the chance that there is a point at x of phi if there is a point which is susceptible at zero and a point which is infected at zero r. Okay, so this is really essentially a third moment measure quantity. And so what you do the same thing. You work out integral relation that relate various, it's enough to look at two of them, second order moment measure in terms of birth, which come from arrival from far away. Okay, this is the far displacement. So there are points here, if you look at the Phi-Phi case, namely the chance to find the percolation between Phi and Phi, which is the chance to find a point which is infected at distance R, okay? Given that there is at the origin a point which is infected. So you will get that because of this far displacement, there will be a burst rate into this into this density, which will be of the time P gamma. And what will be the death, other way of adding mass to that, it will be a transformation where you would initially have a point which was let me try to see what I say here. Sorry, I'm confused here whether what I write is okay. This was first the death rate, right? So you have infected. So first one can recover. This is the beta term. One can move. This is the gamma term. So the rate out. Now in the rate in, in the rate in, you can have one point which was it happened with probability p with rate p which was infected, and now at distance r a new point comes, and because of the far away displacement, this is the gamma thing, okay. Now comes the thing which I wanted to, in terms of the term which comes from the rate in. Yeah. So you look at the a point, okay, and you look at the chance. You look at the infected points which are around, and at the chance that this infected point Yeah, perhaps this one is easier to see. We want to look at the rate out of a configuration of the form of the percolation function between infected and susceptible, right? Okay. So the same argument for the rates which I describe as rate out. Now for the rate in. So you look, yes, so to get susceptible, you had to be infected, right? So you look at the configuration of points which are susceptible around you. And okay, so I must say I'm confused. So let me try to recover my stuff. Okay, so let me erase everything and start again. I'm sorry to confuse you.
It's okay.
Yes. Okay, so let me say again. So I look at this pair correlation function between infected and infected, right? So to get out of that, I can get out of that by either recovery or motion. I can get in this. I can get in this by having initially, say, a point at the origin, which will happen with probability P, and a distance R, having a point that pops from far away, which happens with rate gamma. Okay, it's the far displacement thing, right? And the other thing is the following. How can I get out of that? Here it is, right? So I look at the thing that this point initially was susceptible, okay? And now I look at what happens, and there was a point at distance R which was infected. Then there is a death rate F of R because of the interaction between these two points. Okay, but there also is the chance of dying, not of because of that, but because of other nodes, which are phi thing, which are the other points which are located at X, and which create this rate F of X. Okay. And so that's, I'm sorry to have been mistaken, but I had initially a susceptible point, and this susceptible point becomes infected because either the presence of this infected point at distance R or because of the others. Okay. So sorry for having okay. And so what you get out of that are functional equations which relate moment measures of order 2 and moment measure of order 3. Okay, that's my main point. I'm sorry to have been hesitant here. Okay, so let me now explain the... So is it okay? How much more time do I have?
I don't know, maybe 10 minutes, okay?
Yeah, okay. I'm we're slow. Okay. Now, what I want to do is simplify this heuristic computational things to simplify this functional equation by doing heuristics. And the heuristic goes in terms of representing the moment measures of order 3, these mu things, in terms of simple representations, in terms of the moment measures of order 2. So here is a simple thing which we call the mean value is the heuristic. This, you say that you, it's a heuristic, as I said, that this mu function, which I repeat, gives the density of x of points of phi, given that there is any infected, given that there are susceptibles at zero and R. You can say, look at the influence that this psi has on this point of phi at distance x. So you would write something like that with eta. Eta is a number between 0 and 1 times, so it's a geometric mean of the influence that this point of psi has on the point of phi and that the other point of psi has on the point of phi. Right, so you write an equation of this type. And the same thing for the other moment measure of order 2. Okay, so an example would consist in taking eta is equal 1/2. Okay, there are other things of the same nature which are based on Bayes' rule. And I don't enter into the details, but the idea, I mean, which shows up very well in this mean value heuristic, is that you take this object which is directly as, interpreted as a moment measure of order three, and you factor it in a heuristic way into in terms of moment measure of order two. Okay, these xi functions. And if you do that, let me skip the details. But if you do that, this functional equation, which I was hesitant describing, it took me time to recover, transforms into a set of integral equations. Okay, so there is a whole zoo of them. So this is one of the Bayes formula, and a simple one, where you see this functional equation translating into an integral equation in which you the unknowns are the first moment measure, the second moment measures, so p, xi, and there is p1 minus p, and there are three types of pair correlation function, this one, the joint one, and the last one. And they are linked by the conservation rule, and you remember RCP1, which connects the first one measure and the one of the pair correlation functions. That's it. So for any heuristic which is decent, you get a set of functional equations for linking the first one measures and the second one measures. Okay, and then you start playing with that, and you what you see is that the functions phi xi in function are actually very simple functions. They look like step functions. So you get pictures of this type where in this radius, so r is equal to one, you get one value within this circle of radius one around you and another outside. Okay, and when you what you do is that and these are now the polynomial heuristics that every each of these functions you assume to be almost constant on a disk of radius a and equal to a constant that so we call w the constant for the pair correlation function of susceptible and infected, v the function for infected, and psi. And Z, the last one for the susceptible. And the conjecture of repulsion says that W should be less than one. And so this is another way of phrasing this. Okay, and now you take any of these functional equations, and this is the main tool that we used, and you get a polynomial system. Okay, so this is the polynomial system associated with this Bayes representation of the of the functional equations. Okay, so please have a look at it. So this is the conservation rule that these things are Poisson altogether. This is rate conservation one RCP one, and there are fundamentally two equations. Linking the evolution of the pair correlation functions. There is a dog who appreciates the talk. there is a pair of polynomial equations translating the RCP2, namely the thing which was initially connecting the moment measure equations of order 2 and 3. Okay, and this is the handle. So we got what we want, namely, we studied all these polynomial equations. And the first thing is that, I mean, it works. Namely, we can out of that predict, it's a heuristic thing, but we can predict very well the numbers. So here are, for instance, a comparison of simulation results. So it's not prediction at with four digits, right? But as you see, I mean the numbers when we do by predict by simulation, and one of these this is one of these Bayes formula, the polynomial thing, you get the numbers which really work quite well in terms of predicting the fraction of infected node in steady state. Okay. So this factorization heuristics predict P reasonably well, let's say, right? So there is a zoo, as I said, of polynomial heuristics. And I mean, they sort of, in a systematic way, predict these numbers well. Okay, the main thing I want to insist now is criticality, because this is the phase diagram. Okay, so you take, the principle goes like that, and this is, okay, you take this, and now you sort of do the following mental picture. You want to see for what values of the parameters, okay, P can be equal to zero. Okay, so you will plug in P is equal to zero, or P is very small in this polynomial equation, and see what are the only possible values. You will eliminate, in a sense, out of that W, V, and Z, and there are, you succeed in doing that, and see what are the necessary connection between gamma, beta, and alpha and mu. Okay, so this is the program, and this is what you get. For instance, this is again this Bayes heuristic, which is of the same nature as the multiplicative heuristic or the geometric mean heuristic that I mentioned. P equivalent to very small, or P equal to zero, is only possible if the parameters alpha, mu, and beta, and gamma satisfy this polynomial equation. Okay, there is a parameter rho here that shows up, and this rho is linked in the to the other parameters in this polynomial equation. So rho is alpha mu over beta to the 2/3 for this Bayes case. Okay, and then what you do is you study these things, and what you get are what we call this phase diagram. So for instance, we study this polynomial equation, okay? And you study when the roots, real roots, if you think in terms of this as a value in gamma, okay? You think everything is fixed, and you think in terms of the parameter gamma varying, and you ask for what values of alpha, beta, and mu, this is possible to get values of gamma such that P is equal to zero. Okay, and if a certain condition on the parameters holds, what you get is the values, the critical values of gamma, and there are two, which I will try to explain in a second, gamma plus and gamma minus, which can be expressed in polynomial terms in function of the system parameters. And the analysis shows that if gamma is less than this gamma minus, or gamma is more than this gamma plus, okay, and these are obtained by this very simple polynomial equation, then there is survival. Whereas if gamma is in between, there is extinction. Okay, and the broad picture is that there is a similar result in terms of polynomial equation with values making possible that P be equal to zero. And it will be, if you fix the parameters L than gamma, only possible at certain critical values for gamma. Okay, so this is now the tentative phase diagram that I mentioned, obtained when you study polynomial equations. Okay, the principle I tried to explain, it's based on the analysis of the roots of the polynomial, these polynomials around P is equal to zero. And so it looks like that. Okay. So this is so first there is so this phase diagram in terms of so mu is this parameter which triggers the mean number, the mean degree. Beta is this parameter triggering the recovery rate. Okay, and the broad thing is that there is a safe region above which there is always extinction. So if beta is high enough for a given mu, it will be safe. There is an unsafe region, okay, which is below this line, and this line is separated. This region, this unsafe region, is separated into two subregions, which let me try to describe better here. A region which we call motion insensitive, this UMI region, and a region which is motion sensitive. So in the motion insensitive region, whatever the speed of motion, survival or extinction will take place regardless of gamma. In the most interesting region, which is the motion sensitive region, there will be this gamma plus and gamma minus, which are non-degenerate, and in between which there will be survival, and above which or below which, and that's the surprise, there will be extinction. Okay, and so the broad picture is that all the lines and the curves separating this region from this polynomial equation. As I said, it is a heuristic. But let me describe one of those. For instance, this UMS, so motion sensitive Boolean subcritical region. Okay. In this region, we place ourselves. I've not described all the parameters, but so this is this region, okay, where mu, this mean degree, is below the criticality, the critical parameter for the static Boolean model, and above a certain mu zero, which comes from the possibility of existence of solution for gamma. Remember this word, this equation here. When I said that you need certain conditions for this quadratic in gamma to have solutions, right? So, and that shows a mu naught, right? So if you're in this region, between mu, this mean degree between above this mu zero, which is approximately a 0.34, and this mu star, which is the it's an estimate which was well known on the already on the degree of the Boolean model for percolation to hold, then you get this interesting scenario in terms of motion. In that case, there exists a non-degenerate critical function gamma minus gamma plus that depends on mu and beta. Okay, so you have peaks of mu, there is a beta. Okay, and in for this value of mu and beta, there exists a gamma plus and a gamma minus. If gamma is less than gamma minus, there is survival. If gamma is in between gamma plus and gamma minus, there is extinction. If gamma is high, there is survival. Okay, so rephrased, if there is no motion, there is extinction, because the Boolean model is made of separated clusters, and in any compact, the epidemic will die. If there is small motion, then there is survival. If motion starts, if gamma is less than gamma minus, there is survival. If gamma is moderate, namely between gamma minus and gamma plus, there is extinction. And again, if gamma is big above this gamma plus, there is survival. Okay, so that's the thing that we found interesting, that actually the survival of epidemic in certain regions is not a monotonic thing in terms of the motion rate, right? So as shown by this, so this thing is the expected thing that and it will be natural that for small motion you control better the epidemic, and if you increase motion you have more chance that it survives. But because of the randomness of the medium, there is also a gamma minus, okay, which is such that below this gamma minus, there is survival. And if you increase sufficiently gamma, then there is extinction. And I will try to explain that physically, or to try to explain what are the stochastic reasons for that. Okay, so let me, we have lots of expressions for this gamma curves. I don't want to indulge and say too much on that. What I will conclude by doing is saying a few words on the validation of the phase diagram by simulation. Okay, so it's very difficult, as I said, because I mean, you assess things which are about an infinite particle system, and so the only surrogate you have to think of what is the survival probability is to look at what is called the MTTA, the mean time till absorption, right? Okay. And there are several empirical methods to try to see whether there is survival or what are the, say, the value of gamma, which are critical, which look at, say, inflection points with respect to the parameter, say, beta or gamma, for fixed torus size, or the dependency on the torus size for a fixed value of beta in function of gamma, right? So you simulate on a large torus and you try to see how things evolve and whether the time till extinction increases or stabilizes when the size of the torus gets big for values, given values of the parameters, right? And so I don't want to spend too much time on that, but so let me just conclude by looking, showing these curves, which come from simulation. So this is the mean, so in the region which we discussed, which is this motion sensitive region, okay? This would typically be, let me change color. Okay, this would be the gamma minus, this would be the gamma plus. And what we observe indeed, which is a result, empirical result on large torus, is that indeed the MTTA, the mean time to absorption, decreases for small enough values of gamma, then is, and increases. So, I mean, this is the incarnation on a large tori of the things that we expect to hold in the infinite domain, that indeed, in certain values of the beta mu Hortant, for certain values of beta and mu, there is indeed this unexpected phase transition that for gamma small enough, it survives. For gamma intermediate in this region, it's extinct. And again, for gamma above this gamma plus, it is extinct. It is surviving. Okay, so I'll stop here. Let me, state a few things as a conclusion. There are lots of things to be done. We have to prove the repulsion conjecture. We have to justify this phase diagram. We have to extend the analysis to more realistic variants than SIS. So SIR would be interesting. And currently, the thing is only done for this very simple type of motion, which actually this this random waypoint or lazy random walk with big jumps, right, allows you to get these simple equations for the moment measures of higher order. You can complexify that and get other moment, higher moment measure equations for other motions, but we have not done it so far. Okay, that's it. Sorry to have taken a bit more time. I was stuck at some point, but I think I could find my my track again. So let me stop the screen. Okay.
Okay. Thank you very much. Questions? Okay, clap. First of all. It's surprising the result.
I have a question. Hi,
François. Hi, Pablo. Nice to see you.
Bon, ça va, très bien.
Très bien, très bien.
Yes, this is intriguing. This that for low gamma you have a supercritical behavior, because I was thinking you have a subcritical Boolean model, right? So you have these finite clusters all around. You can think that those clusters are like each cluster like a particle in the contact in the initial contact process, and then this jumping is like an infection rate from one cluster to another one.
Yes.
And then when the jumping is slow, you should be subcritical. Why are you supercritical?
This is my explanation of it, right? So far away, there will be, very far away, there will be super big clusters where epidemic will survive for a very, very long time, right? Okay, and so, and this will be a sort of big clusters, right? They're far away, but okay. And so this is linked to this non-homogeneity, to this random random phenomenon. Okay, and then, so these guys will be rare, but they will come from very far away and start infecting certain clusters, possibly again, big clusters where it will propagate like hell. And okay, and so in a sense, think of it, we thought of it like that. It's super intuitive and we are not sure, right? So this is what this polynomial show and okay. So assume you are, in a super dense thing. So it's cities which are isolated one from the other. You are somewhere in India, something like that. And you have in some cities, there is this reservoir of sick people, right? And suddenly, very rarely, these people take trips, right? So then, although these things are isolated, right? They do not communicate. Whereas if you would, it's a question of whether this thing dissolve. I mean, if gamma increases, these clusters dissolve. And if they dissolve, I mean, what you say, in a sense, intuitively, might hold true, okay. But if they do not dissolve fast enough, then this big jumps from far away, because the result is for very large displacement. So actually, we take infinite displacement. Okay. So this is our intuition. But I said it clearly. This is hypothesis. Let's say. Based on these funny polynomial equations, and consistently, so you take any of these third order factorization, you get the same phenomenon, and it translates. So it's not a proof, but it translates when you zoom there on simulation large tori, then you see that the mean time to absorption decreases in around gamma minus. Which is not a proof, but it's an indication that something surprising is happening. And one natural explanation is the one that in random media, I mean, so it would not happen in on a grid, right? It is really because
this is like a multi-scale analysis.
Yes, yes, yes. It's a random medium phenomenon that, so there is a competition between dissolving these clusters where things take a huge, huge time to vanish, and dissolving the clusters and propagating it, right? So, if you increase gamma,
you dissolve the clusters.
You dissolve the clusters, right? And perhaps do not propagate the disease fast enough to compensate this dissolution. Okay, so this is my understanding. But
okay. No, it's nice. I mean, I buy it.
Okay, so we are not sure it's true. And so the aim of giving such lecture is to ask for a collaboration because, I mean, so we did that in the last few months. And so it's because we had the, we know it, these things work in wireless, right? So this phase transition that we find are the good ones. And, okay, so, I mean, in a sense, it's not a proof, but I mean, it's intuitively, it's what we understand. Okay. Sorry, yeah. For no, mathematician. No, it's
okay. But you, to prove this kind of things, you need a lot of energy.
and a lot of time. And a lot of time. Yes. So.
Yeah.
Right. But what is interesting? What is interesting is that you get things which look, I mean, crazy first, but when you simulate, you see they're there, right? At least in incarnation, I mean, the fact that the mean time to extinction decreases very fast is not a proof. It's not a proof, right? It's an indication that something which you do not expect and which must be linked to that. To this interpretation holds. Mm-hmm. And we found that interesting that to say that, I mean, perhaps lockdown in some cases is not the right thing to do, right?
No, in fact, indeed.
So, okay. So, I mean, sorry for, so it's ongoing work. And so the proof of these things are very demanding and we are not there yet.
Thank you. We were wondering if you have a city or a cluster with infected people, with a lot of infected people. Sorry,
could you repeat? I didn't get it.
No.
Okay. There are questions from the audience.
The little one. Sorry. No, I mean, in this time, it's summertime here in Uruguay, and we were wondering if getting people out of Montevideo to some zones with few cases, it will be useful.
Yeah, I mean, it's exactly the same we were discussing.
Yeah.
It's exactly the same we were discussing, right, yeah. So Pablo's question was really... I mean, if you want to give a reasonable explanation of this thing, at least so, let's put it that way. We are not sure, of course, about the thing in the infinite domain, whether this is really there or not. But our polynomial stuff allowed us to discover parameter regions where the MTTA is a decreasing function of motion rate. That's a fact. And with confidence intervals, you can even make a clear statement that it must be there, right? And that's what we did. I mean, we have confidence intervals in Alaska. Right? So that's not a joke. hopefully.
But you can move a lot. You can move a little bit.
Yeah. Okay.
François,
there are plenty of, yes, please.
What you're moving is the frequency of displacements. The displacements are large.
Yeah, so, it's flight.
What you're
flight.
Saying that this, I mean, reservoirs of infected people that move near you and start a new wave of contagions should last long enough before they move again, in some sense. So if So if you increase the mobility too much, they will be, this is why it's decreasing, I think. So if you increase mobility too much, you get a point where the infected people come from Montevideo to a seaside resort, something, but they stay too little time to generate a big infection. But if you move too many people, and if you increase the frequency of these movements a lot, then they will be replaced by other people that are infected. And will continue the infection. So this is why the U-shaped thing, I think, is happening. Okay.
Yeah, it's another way of looking at it. I think really, it's. I mean, this is competition between dissolution of nasty clusters, which is good for the epidemic to disappear. But there is a cost to that, that you propagate in an infinite domain, you also propagate very far away, right? Okay, so I mean, what is better to dissolve things which are hell as soon as there is infection there, or to take the risk by dissolving them to propagate? This is this tension. And this tension seems to be essential in understanding what's going on in certain parameter regions. It must be very specific. I don't think it has any implication on the Montevideo case, and I don't advocate to go this way too far.
No, it's okay.
But okay, so that's what our applied mathematics shows or suggests. Okay.
Any more questions? No? Well, we thank again.
One question. From the beginning, can you avoid that the initial distribution is homogeneous?
No. Because, I mean, our machinery is based, I mean, if you want beautiful and simple polynomial equations and functional equations, everything is based on translation invariants. So why is it simple in the end? Simple, I mean, so you've seen, you get these polynomial things. I mean, so some people won't call that simple, but I mean, conceptually it's simple. Why do you get that? Because you look at time and space translation invariant problems. And there is some beauty there, which is given by this huge group of transformations, leaving everything invariant, right? Transformation in time, translation in time, translation in space. And therefore, I mean, the polynomial equation, before you get these functional equations, they are simple. Some of them are rigorous, right, before you do the factorization of the Fermat measure. And so this is conceptually simple because you have all these groups acting and preserving everything. Otherwise, I mean, I don't know. But it's homogeneous, but I mean, as Pablo said, I mean, it's very random, right? And so there are clusters where the thing will last for hell a large number of time, because these clusters, if there is no motion, will have a high degree, very high connectivity, and things will propagate there, right, and stay forever. Mm-hmm. Forever, I mean, for a very long time. And so it's homogeneous, but it's a random medium. And otherwise, if it would be grid, nothing like that would happen.
Okay, thanks.
If it does. Okay, so it was more triggered by COVID than deep mathematics, but it's interesting. And so, as I said, so please have a look at the preprint. And if anybody wants to put energy in it, we are asking for it. That would be great to...
I forgot to... Well, I can find it in archive, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Okay. So. Okay, that's what we call very wet research. Okay. Bye. Thanks a lot.
Okay.
No, okay.
Sorry. Sorry to have been. Sorry to have been too long.
I say bye to Ines. Ines Armendariz was saying bye bye. Okay. Yes. She was not to you. Okay. Bye. You're free now. Every Friday we discuss a little bit the situation in Uruguay.
Okay,
so
very good.
We'll say a little bit.
Okay, thanks a lot for the interest, and sorry to have lost my mind for a few minutes, but I think I recovered 5 to 0, right? So
you passed the message, it was okay. We understood the message. So
okay, very good. okay, thank you. Yes, Pablo and Paola and Andres, so I mean, if you're interested in these topics and want to collaborate, and so I'm your man.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Chao, chicos.
Chao, Pablo.
Bueno, chao, Pablo.
Un abrazo.